Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Skip E Lowe Looks at Hollywood. Today's guest is the very lovely and talented Susan Strasberg. And now, here he is, the man of the half hour, Skip E Lowe.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Looking at Hollywood Today. I have a very special show for you today. It's one of my favorite actresses, and she is the very, very fabulous Miss Susan Strasberg. Hello, Susan.
Hi.
When I think of Susan Strasberg, and when I use that word, Susan Strasberg, and hear it, I think of the theater. Now, why?
A lot of people, I guess, do. And it's interesting because I think part of that has to do with my father.
Exactly.
And the Actor's Studio. And that whole association, because actually, career-wise, I started in diapers, but I've been working for 30-some-odd years, and I didn't start. Most of the early things that I did were television. I mean, I did television when they didn't have a peacock, when they had a Miss Color Girl, who was, oh, God, pretty girl with red hair and kind of white skin and blue eyes, yes. The Bird came later. And I did the first color series, I think, ever on television. And I actually did films. I had done two films before I had really done any theater.
But your first, you started at 14, weren't you?
At
14, and what show was that you debuted?
I debuted off Broadway in something called Maya.
Maya, right.
And
that was off Broadway.
Marty Ritt was in it. It had a lot of good directors. Marty Ritt, Leo Penn, Kay Medford was in that.
Kay Medford, was she in that?
Yeah. A lot of people were in it. And then I came to Hollywood.
No, you didn't come to Hollywood. Didn't you go on Broadway? Didn't you do Diary of Anne Frank?
I did Diary of Anne Frank after.
After?
I had done Cobweb with Vincent Minnelli. That was my debut.
You mean you did a movie before you did Broadway?
I did two.
Before you had Broadway?
Yeah. I had done Picnic, and I had done... Wait, Picnic? First I did Cobweb, then I did a lot of television. I did Juliet on Kraft, live television. I mean, a lot of television. Then I came back to California, did Picnic, and I was supposed to do... Funny the way life works.
Right.
I was supposed to do Friendly Persuasion with
Anthony Perkins.
Yeah.
Yes.
With and Willie Wyler was directing it,
who,
and someone I've always wanted to work with. And I was kind of verbally committed, and I got Anne Frank. And I remember, I think I called Mr. Wyler and said, I would not ask, but this is the part of a lifetime, and will you release me? And I'm not sorry that I asked, but I regret that I never worked with
him. You
were
16 when you did Anne Frank?
Yeah.
You were 16. Mm-hmm. Tell me, a 16-year-old girl on Broadway doing a tremendous show like The Diary of Anne Frank. How did Susan Strasberg feel about that?
My father was once asked what he thought about the fact that I became a star.
Right.
So quickly and so early. And I think the analogy he used was, he said, well, you know, success and fame are like a box of chocolates. If you eat a couple of pieces at a time, it's delicious. If you have the whole box, it can give you a stomachache. I got a stomachache at the time.
Yes. But you like the theater, don't you, Susan?
I love the theater.
The theater
I just come off 6 months on the road. I did Agnes of God.
Agnes of God. Who was that with, Susan?
I played it with Peggy Cass, who was just wonderful. And it was very different because people think of her as doing comedy. And it's really the first time in... done some theater. I did a little bit of theater out here at the Westwood Playhouse, but I hadn't really seriously done anything. And that's a difficult show because it's just the three people in the show. That psychiatrist is on stage the entire time. And I mean, if you scratch your nose, they notice because it's all kind of so stark. And it was good. It was almost like I felt like a fighter getting back into training again.
You know what was my favorite movie?
Which
Stage Struck.
Yeah, a lot of people.
I just love that movie.
Yeah.
Tell me about that, your feeling in that movie, Susan. That's a remake of Morning Glory.
Yeah, which I never saw. I still haven't seen
Morning
Glory, no. And I hadn't seen it. I avoided seeing it before because I didn't want to be influenced. Now, that was really, it was my first romantic part at the time. I got Henry Fonda kissed me. It was funny because 20-some-odd years later, I did my first kind of real love scene with Peter Fonda in The Trip. It was like I got
you did that
both
movie, The Trip.
I got the whole family 25 years apart.
Right.
But for when I did the scene with Hank Fonda, I remember they put me on a staircase because he was very, very tall. So I was on a step above him, and I was so nervous. I kept thinking, oh, I'm kissing Henry Fonda. What am I going to do? How do you act this? I mean, I don't. You know, how do you handle it? The film itself was not You know, it's funny, memory is so subjective.
They are,
if
yes.
you and I were to describe this conversation, uh-huh. even in a month or tomorrow, it uh-huh. would be completely different. It wouldn't be that it would be a lie, it would just be that we would pick different things to remember. That being a fairly unhappy experience, partially because my mother...
Unhappy?
My mother, who was an extraordinary woman, and mm-hmm. who coached Marilyn Monroe, Jennifer Jones, people right. like that, was coaching me. Mm-hmm. And I was going through a period, I think I was about 20, and I really was ready to break the apron strings, and yet because I felt dependent
yes, yes.
on my mother
uh-huh.
for the coaching, I couldn't really break away. And I saw the movie recently on television, and I could see, it's funny, when I see Marilyn uh-huh. in, let's say, Some Like It Hot, the Bus Stop.
Bus Stop.
I can see my mother's coaching, that Marilyn's
you
taken
You can really?
Yes, sure. I see gestures and things that were not Marilyn's, a business that my mother specifically gave her.
How about Marlon Brando? Can you see anything about Marlon? He studied with your dad, didn't he?
Well, no, but coaching is different than studying. When coaching means that my mother actually, coaching is someone who goes on the set with you, who breaks down the part. That's
right.
very different than,
yeah.
there's no, if you look at the actors who studied at the Actors Studio,
yes.
there is very little, even stylistically, that they have in common, mm-hmm. except that they're all good, I would like to think. Because if you think, people tend to think, well, the method, and there's a predominance of actors who act uh-huh. very realistically, but on the other hand, if you look at Jerry Page or Kim Stanley or Julie Harris or Walter Matthau,
you're doing my favorites,
or Maureen Stapleton or yeah. Pacino or De Niro uh-huh. Uh-huh. or Jane Fonda, I'm sorry, uh-huh. they're not similar. Uh-huh. In there's no stamp on them that says uh-huh. method or that whole thing.
There isn't. No, there isn't.
Anyway.
Is there? No,
it's just
that
they're
really.
Good.
Yeah. Do you know? I remembered you on Broadway. You did a show, Little Foxes. Didn't you do that?
No, but if I was good, it
Wait
was
a
me.
Minute.
If you,
you
remember,
didn't do you didn't do Little Foxes, Susan.
Tallulah Bankhead did Little Foxes.
No, play but the daughter. Now, who am I thinking of? Who did that
when,
on Broadway?
Well, it would depend when the production was.
Not Tallulah Bankhead. This
but
is
you
the
know,
other one.
It's funny.
I get confused with you with someone else then.
Well, it depends who it is. That could be good or that could be bad.
No,
I think.
You know, I'm looking at you right now. You remind me of Natalie Wood, you know that.
Thank
I must
you.
Tell the audience.
She was
you.
Lovely. A lot of people, we're both small,
small
dark,
same,
and
yes.
similar.
To remind me of Natalie. Did you know her?
Yes. She was lovely. I met Natalie when I came to California again. My mother was with me, and this must have been 50s, I guess, early 50s.
Is that when you came to Hollywood, in the 50s?
Yeah. She was, well, I'd been out here before because my father worked at 20th
right.
for years, but this is after when
yes.
I came out for
yes.
my own work. And we were staying at the Chateau Marmont, and Natalie was rehearsing with Jimmy Dean, who and Jimmy knew my mother, so we
Rebel Without a Cause.
Rebel. Mm-hmm. And I was, I guess, getting ready for Pit. Well, maybe I was doing Cobweb. I may have been doing Cobweb.
Uh-huh.
And I thought Natalie was wonderful. I would say, I had a girlfriend, Steffi, sitting, and I'd say, Steffi, when I grow up, I want to be like Natalie. Natalie was my age,
uh-huh.
but because she was a Hollywood baby, so I mean, she had the fingernails, and she
yes.
was smoking, and
yes.
she was much, much more sophisticated
uh-huh.
at that time
uh-huh.
than I was. And it was so funny. I remember the shock I had when I realized we were exactly the same
uh-huh.
age.
Natalie Wood. That's what I always think of Hollywood. When I think of Hollywood, I think of Natalie Wood. What do you think of her death? What did you thought of that? It was sad, wasn't it?
Anyone who has that kind of early
death. She was afraid of water, too, wasn't she?
Yeah, she had had, I had heard, and I don't know, that she had not just a fear of death. I wonder if sometimes that kind of fear is not almost a precognitive.
Yes,
kind of, I do feel that
You do astrology, don't you? You're into astrology, aren't you, Susan?
Well, I would say that I'm into the mantic arts, whatever that includes. In other words, I guess metaphysics.
Metaphysics.
So it's a... Healing is the field that I'm really the most interested in, and I do some lecturing on it. Healing or the creative process.
Healing of what? Like what?
Well, what do you want to heal? Yourself. In other words,
it's all in the mind.
It's not. There's a mind-body connection.
Yes, right.
But that just the way an actor uses a technique to alter consciousness when he's acting.
Mm-hmm.
What I found is that a lot of the techniques that are used for stress relief, for healing
mm-hmm.
are the same things that actors have been doing for hundreds of years.
True.
I'm younger than Shirley, but I got involved with a lot of
Shirley
MacLaine. So that I, in my book, I have some stories.
Diane Ladd does that too, doesn't she?
Involved, yes.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So that, you know, I believe in reincarnation and things, once, what happens is once you get hooked in to that area, let's say I had a lot of psychic experiences. Mm-hmm. I thought I was crazy. Maybe I am. And that led, one thing led to the other. Mm-hmm. Somebody recently said to me, well, how can you really believe in reincarnation uh-huh. apart from your own? So many of these things are based on empirical evidence. You can only say it happened to me and this uh-huh. experience made me feel that it was valid. But do you know Max Gordon? Max Gordon was a famous theatrical producer.
Oh, right.
And Arthur Schwartz, who wrote That's Entertainment,
that's right.
is a friend of mine, and told me that when he was very young and had just come to New York, was writing songs, Max Gordon kind of adopted him, and they used to hang out together. Max loved the theater uh-huh. so much that he had a bed that he kept in his office above his theater. And one night, they were sitting and discussing life, and Arthur said, well, you know, Max, you believe in a lot of kind of strange things, but, I mean, you don't believe all that nonsense about reincarnation, things like that. Uh-huh. And Max said, oh, absolutely, kid, I believe in it. Uh-huh. And Arthur was sort of stunned, and he said, why? And Max Gordon said, listen, kid, I can't believe I close here and don't open somewhere else. So that's,
that's a cute
story.
For
an actor, you got to go with the next booking.
That's a cute story. You're writing now, aren't you, Susan?
I'm doing
the second book,
yeah.
Second book.
Much, much more, I won't say difficult, much more challenging.
Is it? Could you tell us about it?
Susan? Well, you see, the first one, because it was autobiographical, it had a beginning, a middle, and end. Mm-hmm. And what I was mostly concerned with in Bittersweet was keeping a balance. In other words, not making it revealing without being prurient, mm-hmm. Protecting people so that if there was any villain, it was me, not anyone else
right.
in the books. Because part of, I guess, the theme of that was that ultimately you take responsibility for your own life, mm-hmm. or not. Anyway, the second book is when you get in trouble with a novel, you can't go back to the data. You can't go back to the facts. What uh-huh. you go back to is your own imagination.
Yes.
And because I'm writing, it's a story of a tall, blonde, blue-eyed, Irish Catholic superstar from Hoboken, New Jersey.
Oh, really?
And
where did this come from, Susan?
Someone said, why are you yes. making her like that? And I said, so no one will think it's me. And my girlfriend, Rona Jaffe, said, well, the minute you change it, everyone's going to think it's you anyway. So you might as well. So actually, I've changed a
lot. You want to be a blonde, Susan?
I guess most people, and actors are no different,
true.
Go through a period when you want to be someone else, or you think that it would be easier uh-huh. if you were someone else. And I'll never forget once, my parents used to take a house on Fire Island, and during those summers, mm-hmm. Marilyn Monroe and I would share a room, because it was a small uh-huh. house.
And you shared with Marilyn, did you?
Yeah. And one morning I woke up early and she was standing nude uh-huh. looking out at the beach, and of course I'm looking at her like this, and I was thinking, oh my god, she's so beautiful. And she caught me looking at her, and I was kind of embarrassed, and I said, oh Marilyn, I said, I would give anything mm-hmm. to be like you. Uh-huh. And she looked at me, she said, oh no, Susie, don't say that. I'd give anything to be like you. People respect you.
She wanted respect, didn't she?
I realized that we all, no matter who you are or uh-huh. what, there's always that mm-hmm. suspicion that somebody else mm-hmm. is having an easier time of
yes.
it. Or, and really it isn't if you think about it.
Mm-hmm. Marilyn really wanted respect, didn't she? She thought she didn't have respect. Is that what you think?
Well, she didn't on a certain level.
She didn't?
I don't think she was taken seriously by a lot of people. Uh-huh. First of all,
until she died. After her death.
Yes, because
yes.
then she became, that's what we tend to do in this country. Yes. When people are gone, we lionize.
Susan Strasberg, what kind of a woman really was Marilyn Monroe? I mean, you knew her intimately.
She was much of a complex.
Child, wasn't she?
Well, all good actors have that childish, that child still in them. Mm-hmm. Albert Einstein once said that the most important thing in life was to retain the vision of a child. And that's something that
sure.
actors
sure.
need to do. However, artists don't always make the differentiation between being, I would like to retain that child-like quality, but hopefully I won't be childish.
Uh-huh.
And there is a difference. In other words, you can do what you can have one without the other.
Uh-huh.
Marilyn was much more complex, I think, than people thought she was. She
uh-huh.
was much brighter.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it was street smart, but
she was street smart, wasn't she?
Really bright, uh-huh. yeah. Now, the thing I've learned, or that keep learning, is that emotional capacity and intellectual capacity mm-hmm. very often have nothing to do with one another.
Yes.
That you can be very smart and still emotionally, unless you make that connection.
Yes, yes.
And I've known a lot of brilliant people who couldn't live their lives.
Susan, about your life?
So far, so good.
Do you have a man in your life right now?
Not at the moment.
No?
No. It's funny.
You were married, right, to an actor?
I was married once to Christopher Jones. Wonderful actor.
Yes, he was wonderful.
And
James, very much Jimmy Dean-ish. They claim he was, but he really wasn't. He was
his own quality.
I think
and
so, too.
We have a daughter, Jennifer.
You do have a daughter?
And I was just married for a very short time.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's funny, in talking about... that I was thinking about, when you look back on your life and you say, do I regret, do
yes.
I have any, or things
yes.
being easier for someone else. I had a dream around the beginning of this year that this kind of Indian type guru in a loincloth mm-hmm. came and was adjusting my spine, you know,
yes.
the way a chiropractor
does.
And my spine was going, and I looked up at him and I could feel my spine cracking. And I looked at him and I said, you know, you're fixing my back is giving me a lot of pain.
Uh-huh.
And this man in the dream looked me right in the eye and he said, no. He said, I'm giving you change. Your resistance is giving you the pain.
Ah.
And it seems to me when I, in retrospect, that
mm-hmm.
life tends to offer change and opportunity if you are flexible enough to take it. But most of us go kicking and screaming all
yes,
the way.
Yes, yes. So you really don't regret your life, do you, Susan?
No. And I don't even, my feeling is, you know, when you say, well, would I have done it any differently?
Yeah,
I like where I am. Now.
You do.
And everything that I did, good, bad, or indifferent,
mm-hmm.
is part of that tapestry. So if you took out the painful times, let's
yes.
say, or
yes.
the difficult times, those are the times that I feel helped me to grow
uh-huh.
or change my perspective, the way I handle
mm-hmm.
things. And because I like now, if you took away some of the threads of the past, I would change today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe... Do I have time? There's a very
of
story
course,
that I
you
love.
Tell.
Which I,
Go into yours.
There's a story. There's a man who was lost in a forest, and he finally kind of found his way into this clearing.
Uh-huh.
And in the middle of the clearing, there was a log cabin and this old man sitting rocking back and forth, smoking a corncob pipe. And there were two roads on either side of this cabin, so this man who's now starving from being lost and exhausted
mm-hmm.
from being lost in the... in this forest, goes up to this man and says, excuse me, sir. He says, which one of these roads go to town? The nearest town. And the old man looks at him and rocks, and he says, they both go to town. He says, well, which one should I take?
Mm-hmm.
And the guy says, well, the road to the left is going to take you the swamp route. He says, now, he says, there's a lot of alligators and quicksand in
uh-huh.
that swamp, but it'll get you to town. He says, now, the other road, he said, that's the mountain road.
Mm-hmm.
He says, now, that mountain road, we got a lot of mountain lions and bears mm-hmm. around here. He says, and a lot of rock slides, he says, so that's pretty bad. So the guy looks at him and says, well, tell me which one to take.
Mm-hmm.
Which one's the best road? And the guy looks at him and says, listen, let me put it to you this way. Whichever one you take, you're going to wish you took the other one. And I suspect that life's like
life
that,
is that
sometimes.
Yeah,
yeah,
it is. It is, really, Susan. So you really don't regret your life now. Are you living in New York or California?
I go back and forth.
You do.
In other words...
you prefer New York, don't you?
No, I lived here for 15 years.
Did you really?
And it's so strange because all the time that
I think
I've lived
of you as
here,
a theater actress. I don't
I
know why I don't think you have movies.
All the time that I've actually done maybe 10 plays in my life, and I must have done about 40-some-odd movies. So
Isn't
really
that strange? When I never thought of that.
Yeah.
Because I connect you with your father, see, that's what
But what's
is.
So strange is that all the years that I lived out here, people would say... Oh, Susan, how are you? When did you get into town?
Uh-huh.
I'd say about 10 years ago.
So you're living
it's
in...
just another new face
so you
in town.
So you're bi-coastal right now, then?
Yes.
Yeah, I see. And you're writing out here now?
I write anywhere I go.
Is
when I was
you?
On the road, I took all the...
You were saying about...
The,
let's get back to you on the road. You just...
Mm-hmm.
Lecture. You say you're lecturing on the road, or...?
I just did a play on the road.
Right.
But I have... I started about 2 years ago doing some lecturing, and I...
Mm-hmm.
came about accidentally. I got a call one day and someone said, will you replace Claire Bloom? She can't do her one-woman show.
Oh.
And do you do one? I said, well, how long is it? And they said, an hour. I
mm-hmm.
said, well, what did she do? And they said, well, she did scenes and this and that. And I said, yeah, I do one of those. And I got off the phone. I said, oh, what am I going to do? And I sat down and I wrote a show I used as a frame.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to have kind of equal amount of humor and of kind of not tragic, but, you know, to me it was important because it wasn't just for women's groups. There's this huge flourishing business around the country.
There is, isn't there, for one woman or for one person show?
Well, more than that, it's like Alan J. Lerner goes and takes and sings all his songs, or Henry Kissinger comes and does, it's called, what are they called? It's not lecture series, it's called town hall series.
Yeah, yes,
and
right.
Colleges also. Yeah. And they're terrific because the people are hungry for it, and they're very responsive. Mm-hmm. And
it's 1 hour, just 1 hour.
It's just 1 hour. Mm-hmm. And I do scenes. And what's nice about it also is that you can do anything you really want.
Really?
I can tell jokes, I sing, I tell all the stuff you wanted to do. You can play all the parts you never got a shot at.
Great.
So that it's a
you
lovely
You like to do
experience.
Comedy, Susan?
I love comedy. I haven't, strangely enough.
You haven't really, have you?
In films, the only thing that I did, well, Picnic was funny.
Yes.
On stage, I've done a lot of comedy. A lot. I mean, the thing that I did a Time Remembered, which was Helen Hayes and Richard Burton. That was a comedy. Some O'Casey, I did a lot of Shaw, which is all comedic.
Yes.
And I think that the reason I haven't done a lot of comedy is that because, although it's been 30 years, or maybe not 30 years, I have to go on my fingers. Anyway, however long it's been since I did Anne Frank, that because that was so strong, such a powerful beginning, people tend to think of me as to, and I do, I love doing serious things also, but God, I'd love to, you know,
Susan,
put on a little more makeup and high heels and do a comedy.
Lee Strasberg, your father, naturally.
Yeah.
Really, Lee Strasberg is method actor. He's a method actor, instructor, is that correct?
He was,
would you say he was,
well,
right.
He was kind of the...
But what did you thought of his instructor? What did you thought of your father? If he wasn't your father, now what kind of a man, was he a great, everyone thinks he's great. Is he, was he really that great? That's why I want
to. I feel that he was, yeah.
He was.
He was extraordinary.
He was,
yes. It's funny, I was reading a book.
What made him so great?
Well, the right combination of emotion, intellect, and talent for what he was doing.
Right.
I also think that he cared. He had a passion about acting. And it had, I mean, it didn't matter whether it was theater, because theater or films, as you see in his own performances
that
he did in film. And I think he showed also that the work he was doing, you know, in the early days, people said, well, it's fine for theater.
Yes.
It wasn't, because half of our movie stars now have
are great actors.
Had worked, and had worked, not just with my father, but with my father, Uta Hagen, and other people teaching.
Did you know
things.
Brando? Did you?
Yeah.
What kind of man
not
was
that? Well.
Yeah, what kind of man,
what kind of man was he?
Well, he was young.
I imagine the same kind of man he is, but I don't really know him now. When he was young, he was wonderful. Of course, you know, the thing is, you see, I was younger. If he was young, I was even younger, so that you see what you want to see. I just thought he was so romantic, and I guess everybody was in love with either Marlon or Jimmy Dean in those days.
Who's your favorite? Susan Strasberg, you're a great actress. Who's really today? Who's your favorite people? Do we have any out there?
Oh, we've got a lot of them.
Like
so
who?
It's hard to.
I know De Niro and all that, but the young. How about the young coming up
you
people?
Mean young.
Young, yeah. Do you believe we have great actors out there as young?
You're always. You know what? Susan? A great actor can't be a great actor until he gets great
to work.
Parts.
Yes, right.
So that a lot of the young actors haven't yet come into their parts.
Do you see anything out there?
Parts or actors?
Actors.
I don't know,
or
I
parts,
look.
Too. there are a lot of... the parts are coming up for women, though.
I certainly hope so.
Yeah.
I think so, too. For a while, I think in the sort of throes of that redefinition of sort of woman's place in the world, it was very confusing. What was interesting to me was that it was really men who were writing
right,
this.
Right, right, exactly.
Women keep saying, well, we need more parts, but then when women would come out with scripts, by and large, they would be men's scripts, not and vice versa.
Yes.
But it always, to me, it seems it goes in cycles, you know, that you look and say, oh, there's nobody coming up. There are no playwrights. There are no actors.
But there are.
And then you turn around, they're there.
Yes.
It's a little bit like the stars. Mm-hmm. You look up and you say, there are no stars tonight.
Yes.
Well, there are stars. It's just it's cloudy and you don't see them.
Yes, true. Do you prefer to live in New York or California?
I prefer wherever I am at the time. There are things that I love about California. I love the beach. I love the sun. I have a lot of friends here. I have as many friends here as I do there. I love the change of pace. I'm a Gemini. I need
you're,
change.
I am too.
You see.
You a Gemini? What?
You poor man.
I'm June 6th.
That's right. Nobody's perfect. I forgive you. And
we have a good sign coming up. I mean,
that's a terrific
things coming
year.
Up are
yeah,
good
should
for
be
us.
A lot of changes and wonderful, a lot of wonderful
yes.
stuff.
Uh-huh. Susan Strasberg, I'd like to know one thing.
I'll never tell. What?
I'd like to know what makes you very happy. Because you are happy. It seems that you're very happy. You're happy in life right now, aren't you?
Yeah, I feel very blessed. My life has been very good to me. I think that the thing that's making me happier at this point in my life is that I am more at peace with myself.
I see it. Isn't that strange? I feel
and
it.
And so it's not, I'm not, if you were saying, well, when I was younger, I went for the gold ring, you know, on the merry-go-round, or I went for some, I always thought that there was going to be something outside, out there, and I was going to get it.
Uh-huh.
And when I got it, I was really going to be happy. And all those external things, look at all the people who did get it, whether it's mm-hmm. it's Presley or Monroe or Jimmy Dean or Monty Cliff or Judy Garland, they got it. And
but
it didn't make them happy.
They
and
didn't make them happy.
Somehow there was a shift that took place in my life where I started seeing that was all terrific, by the
uh-huh.
way.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I love all the whipped cream and the topping
uh-huh.
on the cake.
Uh-huh.
And that has nothing to do with really maybe who I am or what I'm about or what I really need
uh-huh.
and want for myself.
Yes.
And once I clearly defined that for myself, it made things a lot easier. Of course, you should see me on a bad day.
Susan, you have something you're it's happening
oh,
at the
yeah,
hotel.
Oh yeah, something terrific that I'm doing. I'm looking only because I don't want to get it wrong.
That's
but
right,
I'm dear. Doing it. It's the weekend of the 7th, 8th, 9th, and
uh-huh.
it's Hollywood International.
The Hollywood International Hotel.
No, you know, it's at the Sheraton Premier Hotel.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And people, it's open to the public, which
uh-huh.
is what's interesting. And the Hollywood International is a nonprofit group, and they'll eventually start a museum,
uh-huh.
and
uh-huh.
it's to preserve. Hollywood, and you know, if you think that we preserve a lot of things that are less worthy
right,
of preserving,
right.
but that we don't have a museum
true.
Here, we don't keep hold of our
mm-hmm,
past.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so they're having a weekend where there are seminars and things
yes.
open to the public, so there'll
mm-hmm.
be a lot of stars coming in, and I'm doing one on fantasy and scary
mm-hmm.
movies.
Oh.
Then they have an award ceremony,
mm-hmm.
which is also open to the public,
uh-huh.
on the 9th,
mm-hmm.
in which
mm-hmm.
I'm the co-host,
yes.
and it's people like, I think, all the Hill Street Blues people, John Forsythe,
and that
Hal
day,
Roach.
That day is what?
Cesar Romero. It's the 9th.
The 9th?
I think it's Sunday night.
Sunday
but
night.
It's like there's a soap opera panel.
Susan, time has gone so quickly. This is it.
Time flies, even
yes.
when you're not having fun. It's been lovely.
Did you? Thank you.
I really enjoyed
thank
it,
you,
too.
Thank you, Susan. Ladies and gentlemen, you really have been looking at Hollywood today. And a lot of New York. This is Skip E Lowe.
And a little New York on the side.
Yeah. I like that.